Coming up, a desperate struggle to save two men from nature's fury. And a girl clings for life on a wheel of terror. On the Bering Sea, off Alaska's frigid coast, sailed the Alaskan Monarch and its crew of six. Crabbers all, and fearless in the face of ocean's fury, they knew not what awaited them. The sea, once their provider, was about to turn against them.
We could see that the harbor was frozen. The tide was packing the ice tighter around us.
We got about 90 degrees around and got a big ice floe stuck in the bow. We stopped moving right opposite these rocks. We couldn't get any commercial help, couldn't get any help from the fishing fleet. By 4 o'clock in the afternoon, it looked like there wasn't going to be anybody to help us out.
The ice was beginning to compact on the boat, and we lost our rudder that next morning.
About 7 in the morning, we got a phone call from our operations center in Kodiak, telling us that, hey, we've got a mission for you guys. We need you guys to fly up, get some parts from the harbor master in St. Paul, and fly them out to the vessel. They're a couple miles offshore.
The waves start to get deeper, the wind picked up.
And that was when things started getting rough.
Some of these big swells came in, and one hit us and washed right over the house. Turned us completely around with the bow heading into the rocks.
We knew that we were in a little bit more serious situation because the swells were becoming 10, 15 feet by then. We were getting hammered.
I wondered, how much can this boat take?
We arrived on scene, and when we did, they were just off of the cliffs. Suddenly, we had to switch gears. This is not just an assistance mission. We are now looking at a potential rescue.
Now it was inevitable. The ship would soon be lost. Faced with no recourse, the captain was forced to give the command he dreaded most, abandon ship. Fierce winds buffeted the chopper. Frozen seas slammed the ailing monarch. Miraculously, the first four sailors were lifted without incident.
After the fourth guy got off the boat, me and Morse were still standing up there, and boom. The bow of the boat hit real hard onto something.
And that's when we decided to get off the boat.
The captain said, we're on the rocks, we went off.
So I said, okay, let's go. And I opened up the door.
We were sitting there watching as the captain and the engineer went across the mid-deck.
I turned around and I saw out of the corner of my eye that wave.
And just crushed. And we were sitting there watching, oh no, did you see that?
And the next thing I remember, I was looking up and the boat was coming down on top of me.
First thoughts in our mind were, did they survive? We couldn't lower the basket immediately. All we could do was sit there for several seconds just waiting for the sea to give us a chance. And these waves were just hammering these guys. We had no idea if they were conscious, if they were injured, or in all honesty, if they were even still alive.
I was laying on my back flat out, and there was a big chunk of ice sitting on top of me. I looked at the chopper, and I knew she couldn't do nothing. I looked at shore, and there must have been 200 or 300 people standing there. And I looked at them, and I go, wow, they're not going to be able to do anything either. You know, all these people, I'm dying in front of all these people. I looked again out of the corner of my eye, and another wave was coming at me. I looked at that wave, and I seen huge pieces of ice in there. It looked like pianos coming at me. I thought for sure that was the one. That was it. It was over. I was going under, and there was nothing that was going to save me. boom, took that piece of ice off me, and it was amazing. I was saved by the wave that I thought was going to kill me.
Well, at that point, the ocean was making up our mind for us, because it wasn't just one wave, it was a series of waves. I opted to first put the basket down and see, okay, are these guys capable of getting in?
When she dropped the basket, she dropped it right there. I mean, I had to move a little bit, you know, to crawl towards it. And once I got my hands on that basket,
he just hopped it, no problem at all. In fact, I don't think I've ever seen anyone get in a basket as fast as he did.
Next thing I knew, I was sitting inside the door with one of the Coast Guard fellows leaning over me. I go, well, you gotta get the skipper. You gotta get that guy. You have to get that guy.
The captain was pinned with a block of ice on his chest, so we weren't gonna be able to pull him straight out. We decided to pull him out with the aircraft. We set the basket back down to him. We were able to just kind of finesse him and ease him a few inches out from underneath that block.
And I reached up and grabbed the basket, and they pulled me out from underneath it.
You're only dealing with inches, but you're able to pull him up into the cabin.
Timing on that basket is what saved me. If I couldn't have got away from that ice cake, this next swell coming would have buried me.
We landed at St. Paul Airport. We're met by an ambulance. We're able to transfer everyone. And in honesty, the 5.5 hours it took us to get there, it took us 15 minutes from the moment we arrived on scene to when we were shut down with all six on board.
I'm not a devout Christian, but I know somebody was watching over me.
When the Alaska Monarch went aground that day, yeah, it changed my life forever. Took me off of the sea.
This was to be the final voyage of the Alaskan Monarch.